And for today's session, for this particular session, we have very eminent speaker, Dr. Jagat Shah with us. He's CEO and founder, Global Networks Vibrant Markets. Dr. Jagat Shah has a PhD in international business. He has worked as Trade and Investment Commissioner of Government of Manitoba, Canada, for 9 years in India. Currently, he's running a global market research firm, Vibrant Markets, which conducts market research assignments for global and Indian markets. He has successfully led Mentor on Road USA Road Drive, a very popular program in 2017, supported by US Commercial Service, US Department of Commerce, and Startup India on New India 4.0 and business opportunities for American companies in India. Now, by the time Dr. Jagat Shah, he joins us, I would like to share very interesting details on this mentor on road trip in India. Please just excuse me for 1 second. Hello, Supratib, I would just, sorry for the interruption. Dr. Shah has joined us. Please help him reach out to the stage area. Thank you. Yes, so we were talking about the very interesting aspect of this mentor on road. So right now, Dr. Shah is also known as mentor on road. He has been given this title. The reason being because he has conducted two mentor on road trips very successfully. One was done in 2017 in United States. Another was in 2015 in India. So for the Indian trip, he has reached out to 22 states, driving almost 12,000 kilometers, meeting small, medium companies and startups to understand their pain points of doing businesses. And he compiled a report of like almost 49 one-liner policy recommendations. And he has submitted it for improving ease of doing business in India. So such kind of initiatives Dr. Shah has taken. And similarly, on similar lines, he performed another mentor on road trip in United States, where he covered 21,000 kilometers in United States, covering almost 35 states, 35 cities in United States, over 82 days meeting with more than 4,000 American companies and startups. So with this, we really hope to hear wonderful and exciting experience and his experience and stories from Dr. Shah. And I'm sure you're going to enjoy having such a mentor on road with us today on this virtual platform. So with this, I invite Dr. Jagat Shah to deliver his speech for the day. So Pradeep, do we have Dr. Shah here? No, sir, we cannot hear you.
Good morning, sir. Kindly reuse that link to join in again. And then click on share audio and video.
So meanwhile, by the time Dr. Shah joins us, I would again like to take you all through the event schedule for the day. So far, we are done with the phase one technology showcasing and followed by the speaker session, which is going to happen now. After this, we have another phase two.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes. Please, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. You.
My welcome. Video. Yes, sir. Welcome. We have already given a brief introduction, and we have you have missed that introduction, so we would like you to.
I know myself. I know.
Thank you, sir, for being here with us. It is wonderful to have you. Please, sir, you can start your session. The stage is all yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Tripti and ITTO, for inviting me. My friends, what I'm going to do, I'm simply going to narrate some practical experiences, but I will relate it to the government academia industry linkage and what is being done and what can be done, and particularly in comparison to some of the developed countries, what are the lessons and best practices. So my belief is like this, that I'm primarily a student of competitiveness, and I follow the competitiveness model in my work all over. And my definition of competitiveness is fourfold, and in this fourfold I'm going to incorporate these aspects of best practices as well as global examples and Indian examples, what is working, what is not working. So I define competitiveness as efficiently creating goods and services which meet global market demand, leading to rising living standard for everybody in the society, and which is sustainable into the future. So the first two is economics, the next two is social economics, if you may call. So, and my work primarily has been, I have been doing work in many fields, but my core competence lies in international trade. So I have always believed that exports is the benchmark of competitiveness. Why? Because a lot of people tell me, why you promote exports when India itself is such a big country as a market? Indian companies should market in India. Whole world is trying to do business in India. Why should Indian companies export, particularly SMEs? So my answer to that is that when a company starts exporting, it not only competes with companies within the country, but it competes from around the world. So it is preparing itself for any eventuality which may happen in the Indian economy, number one. Number two, when we start exporting, we come to know about best practices in the world. And when we bring those best practices to India, our Indian business improves. Now, third aspect I want to speak about is the triple helix of competitiveness, where I place government on the top, academia and industry. So academia and industry is the base of a competitive economy. If we look at Indian context, the government to academia is all right. You know, government decides all education policy and what needs to be done, how a degree is to be given. Now the new education policy is there, and academia would implement it, do compliance. Nothing great to talk about, but yeah, it's moving, you know, it's okay. So government to industry is also okay. Nothing great. So much improvement needed, of course, we all know, but it's okay. Government is deciding industrial policy, finance policy, taxation policy, whatever, and industry follows. The academia to industry is weak, in my opinion, quite weak. So industry keeps saying that when people graduate from our education system and when they come to us, they are not skilled. They do not understand, they do not know the reality of the, you know, business world. And academia says that industry doesn't take any interest in academia, you know. So there is a kind of a gap here. Ultimately, this government academia industry linkage or triple helix leads to very simple job creation, self-employment, MSMEs, leading to taxation for government. So there is an interest in of government. There should be a strong interest of government to make academia industry work, because it is actually fulfilling the objective of the government itself. So now I come to this definition of competitiveness. So efficiently create goods and services that meet global market demand, leading to rising living standard for everybody in the society, and which is sustainable into the future. Now, in each of these four components, I will try to elaborate this government academia industry linkage. That, for example, let's begin with efficiently create goods and services. Now, what is the role of government in this? And so if we see this mentor on road, which I did on India, it was on ease of doing business. Our ranking at that time when I did the tour was something like 152 or something out of 189. And over a period of years, we have seen it has improved to, you know, 130, 129, 166. So which is commendable. Ease of doing business is what is efficiently create goods and services from government perspective. But it still needs to, a lot of improvement has happened on paper, on ground also, but much more has to be done. Then if we look at manufacturing policy of India, that is there, but do we have a service policy? See, 66% of the GDP of India comes from service sector. And it is a huge export market potential. Our core competence of India lies in service sector. For manufacturing, we still have so many challenges. And that is why a country like China is a manufacturing leader, right? But we are a service sector leader. Do we have a service sector policy? We should have one. And that is where this definition of competitiveness fits in and the role of government. At the same time, Make in India, amazing program. This program should have been there from 1948. So Make in India is an example of what is the role of a government. I still remember when Make in India was launched, we were importing LED screens, I think, on which the program was launched from China, almost 4,000 crore worth of. Now today we have 16 factories in India which makes LED screens. And there are a whole list of examples. So that's a very interesting, and now that is translated into Atmanirbharta, which is the role of the government. The Digital India program is very interesting. So in Digital India, again, it is talking about, primarily making life easy for everybody in the society, including business people. Recently, customs was made faceless customs. So that is amazing. Already income tax is faceless income tax, filing of returns and assessment. Export policy, very, very critical, and export incentives. Government talks of zero effect, zero defect. So zero defect is related to efficiently create goods and services. I'm just trying to give some examples, and then I'll relate the role of government to academia and industry, and between all the three of them. Now let's move with the same efficiently create goods and services to academia. What is academia? Academia is an institution which has faculty and students and management primarily. What can it do in field of this competitiveness for efficiently create goods and services? Technology-based research. Why? Today, go and ask any small medium enterprise in India that what technology are you using? He will explain, he or she will explain the technology, and then ask them, do you know what is the best technology in this business in the world? They have no idea. They do not know. They say, where do I find? This is what academia needs to do. 20 for priority manufacturing sectors of India, identify the technologies relevant to small medium enterprise, not to large companies, small medium enterprise, and do a research on that. Come out with videos, for example, and present to the industry. That is industry academia linkage. Industry academia linkage means what is the pain point of industry? Give a solution to that. And that is the strength of academia. The faculty along with students can do wonderful work. I'll give some examples of how it's happening elsewhere. So now what we are doing, there is a pain point in industry saying, I don't know technology. A few days back, I was interacting with gym equipment companies under a Quality Council of India program by DPIIT, and the gym manufacturers were saying, we do not know. We are importing 850 crore of gym equipment from China. And they said, we want to manufacture, but we do not know about the technology. So, but because they are small, medium enterprise, they do not have those deep pockets and resources. So academia can play that role. I gave you one example. Every industry has this kind of challenge from SME perspective. And a survey, it can start from a survey. Just pick up a few clusters or industries and do a survey through faculty and students And I'm sure somebody would fund it because, you know, these all these associations are there from this industry who have a vested interest in this. I recall when I think June or July, we did a program with NASA and on technology transfer. And we were stunned. We were stunned to find almost more than 1,000 technologies which they were wanting to, you know, share with the world. And it was so well presented. So that is something which perhaps I want to give an example. And then prototype. This is also something which needs to be done at academia level. And showcase. For example, I remember I used to do a lot of work in China. I'm talking of 1990s. So China had created a permanent expo for technology showcase and for small medium enterprise. The big companies in China never had a problem of technology because they would always hunt out, they would do partnerships, they would not maintain any patent respect, they would not maintain any trademark respect. They don't care. Their rules and things are different, but you know, they will still get the technology by signing those agreements and then they'll copy it to suit Chinese systems. But that apart, the fact remains that they, even till today, they have a permanent expo where academia and government are partnering. Industry is also a partner. And they showcase every latest technology which either China is developing or from somewhere it comes. Then it is for the industry to pick up. So this is another example of academia, industry, government, you know, kind of a linkage. And then now I come to the industry part of it on efficiently create goods and services. So the application of all this is the role of the industry. And industry, my friends, it is very difficult to run business in the world, in India. It is not easy. Entrepreneurship has so many challenges, right? So these entrepreneurs are taking risk and they are creating jobs. I don't know if there is a proper survey. I don't recall that how many jobs SMEs create, particularly I'm talking of in the country, and how many industry creates. I'm sure it must be 80%, right? Or maybe even more. So and they take a risk. There are these fluctuations. Now COVID came and whole year, so many businesses were closed. What was their fault, right? So there has to be. Now let me give two very interesting examples of academia, industry, government connect. So I remember one university in Ahmedabad. I'm based in Ahmedabad. One university in Ahmedabad, there is an innovation center and they got their students and I was addressing them and I said, we were discussing about innovation. I said, let's do one thing. Tomorrow, you go out into Ahmedabad city. No need to come to college. Go out and walk 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours. No cycle, no scooter, no bike, no car, no bus, no nothing. Walk. Walk as much as you can walk, wherever you want to walk. And just observe people and find out what are the pain points. So this is the industry, this is the academia which has taken the lead. So they did it. And then after 2 days, we had an interaction. Everybody said something, I observed this. And one person, one boy, he said, I observed that the buses, I was sitting in the bus stand having water and taking rest. And a bus came and the first step of the bus was very high and elderly women and children were finding difficult to climb. So, you know, so primarily we had told them to find out pain point of society. So they presented it. And then we said, okay, what is the solution? So they said, can we do something like this, that when the bus comes and stops, there is a hydraulic driven step which comes out. So, and then it goes back. Why? Because when we investigated with Gujarat State Road Transport Corporation that why this is so high, they said the speed breakers in the roads are very, very steep and high. So when the bus with all the people on the backside goes over it, the first foot breaks because of that speed breaker, because of the pressure. So we keep it high. But are you serving society's need? It is so difficult. You ultimately, your customer is that person who is climbing the bus. So we suggested this model, this boy suggested, and they said, we will try. So prototype was built, supplied, 3,000 order came. He was still in second year, I think fourth or fifth semester midway. And he started a company and they supplied it through from the university itself. The university gave him a room inside the university to start this company. Nowadays, all startups work like that in a education system. And then they furnished the, they were, it was so difficult for them to do, and they still did it. And then they took that order and went to Bangalore and spoke to the Bangalore Road Transport. Now it's a, I think I was hearing that it's almost 4 to 5 crore rupees business. Not only they did not seek a job, they created so many jobs. So this is a very interesting example. And government, see government, GSRTC government, academia, and the student itself became an industry. And of course, industry supported, because there were so many things they had to go out and do the job work. So I'm sure there are so many examples in the country. So this is efficiently create goods and services, part of it, and the role of the three. Now I come to the second part, global market demand. That meets global market demand. My belief has always been like this, that whatever business you do, whatever manufacturing you do, trading you do, service sector, there is no service, in my opinion, in India which cannot be exported. There is no product in India which cannot be exported. For 20 years I have been talking this, I have been challenging people, come to me, tell me, this is a product or this is a service which cannot be exported. And I'll prove you wrong. I'll not prove you wrong. I'll show you someone in India who is exporting it. Just to give you two quick examples so that you know you can relate. In Gujarat, there is a company which is exporting goat dung. In Gujarati, we say bakri ki lindi. It is exporting to US. Walmart is their buyer. And they are making it such attractive packaging, and it is sold at $3 a box, which is used as a manure for the rose plants. There's another company which is exporting rotten potatoes, and it is exporting to Saudi Arabia, to a multinational company who has developed a patented product which is in which this rotten potato starch is added, and they have made a brick, small brick, kind of a thin brick, which is sold to airlines. When they add this brick in the aviation fuel which they are putting, it increases the mileage of the aircraft by 30%. And in his purchase order, it is written that if more than 5% is good quality potato, payment will be deducted. Right? So it's a very interesting case of quality. So what I'm trying to tell is there is a market for everything globally. And once we our business is global oriented, we learn these best practices. Now, what is the role of government in this? What is the role of government, academia, and industry in the second part of the competitiveness? So now you see, I was in this lockdown, we were doing a lot of webinars, and we call it Vibrantinars, all over the world. And we came to know that in US, the kind of growth which e-commerce had in last 5 years, they had in last 6 months when pandemic started. So e-commerce became so big, even in India, I don't know Indian data, but must be huge e-commerce growth. So government's role, now government, I was reading that is working with Amazon to create a marketplace for a small medium enterprises for export. And then when I researched further, I found that already in Amazon, 15,000 crores up to July 2020, 15,000 crores of goods by Indian SMEs was exported. So can we have some kind of a, you know, initiative there where government, academia, and industry works? So this Amazon example is a very good one, I believe, because government has taken the initiative. Amazon is the private sector. Indian SMEs are involved, but I'm still not able to see where government, academia is playing a role. Maybe they are playing, I am not aware, but can we play? Can there be a very, very interesting things can be done by academia in this global market e-commerce state? Now, second aspect is, see, I am relating things to today's scenario where COVID is there and where, you know, people are not moving out. Even in US, we have so many clients in India for whom we do marketing strategy development, and when they call US, nobody is in office. How do you get through to them? You want to speak to them about your product. They are at home, but you don't know their home number. You don't know their mobile number. You know, so virtual expo is a very interesting aspect of it. This is what government, perhaps with academia and industry, should do. Today, this event which is taking place is amazing. I was just going through all the aspects of it, the networking, the B2B meetings, the sessions, the interactions, the expo is here. This is what, and you know, I was very surprised between June to December last year, 2020, 940 global virtual expos were organized, and out of that, 770 were organized by China. We are always late in catching up with any new development. We have to be so fast. So that is something, again, an area of partnership where there is a strategic initiative. Because see, a small medium enterprise cannot organize a virtual expo, or even a large company. Academia itself cannot. It has to be a partnership between the three. The third aspect is now the new export policy is coming probably in a month or so. And I hope all this is captured in that. A lot of recommendations have been given. And warehousing again. Again, I relate to China's experience. And I'm talking of competitiveness. I'm talking of connect between government, academia, and industry. So what I remember, because I was part of that, because I used to work in a Chinese company. So we were participating in that program where academia, one university, Chongqing University, came to us saying, we are doing a research that if we open a warehouse for the province companies in US, then how much space we will need. So can you tell me how much will you take? So what is the market size of your business in US? How much is China doing? How much you are doing? How much you think can be done if we do a warehouse? Because what happens in a warehouse? You have next day delivery. You have quality people come and see and buy, no quality claims. And payment rotation is fast. You can open a bank account. So the academia prepared an entire project report and then went to the government saying, we worked with the industry to prepare this. Now this is the budgetary support required. And they did it. My own company, we were operating out of 22 such warehouses, right? We were in textile business there. So this is very interesting, another example. Now, in the global market demand, in the global marketplace, what academia can do? So again, this example I'm relating, research. Our faculty and students together can do research, survey. A lot of people in the lockdown were saying, how to do survey? How to do survey is virtual survey. Everything is virtual. Virtual expo. How to do expo? Virtual expo was happening. People used to say earlier, many export promotion councils called me in April and said, we used to take export delegations. Now we cannot take. I said, you do virtual trade mission. Virtual trade mission. Everything can be done virtual. That's the power of digital India. So virtually survey can be done. And then this kind of a, what is the pain point? See, the thing is that perhaps the academia can take lead and efficiently create goods and services and interview SMEs pain points, global market demand pain points of SMEs, and then develop a paper for the government as a solution example, or even for the private sector. Here I will narrate a very interesting example. When I was driving in US, and I started from Boston to Tampa, Tampa to San Diego, San Diego to Seattle, and Seattle to New York. So Boston, I was in Harvard, and Nitin Noria was the dean at Harvard Business School. So I was just interacting with students and him. And then privately, he told me when we were in his office, I saw a report Coca-Cola on there. I said, what is this about? So he told me very interesting thing. And this is so much related to what we are speaking today. He said Coca-Cola was losing market share in Tanzania to Pepsi and some other companies. So they came to us saying that we want your students to do a research and give survey and report to us on two parameters. One, why we are losing market share. And if we have to regain and grow, what we need to do. And he told two of our professors and six of our students are doing this project for next 6 months. And it is their credit. It is their, this is the only thing they will do. There is nothing else. Right? And they were charging, I think $80,000 or something, I don't remember, to the company as a fees. And that fees was being charged, being shared between Harvard professors and students. All of them had a particular percentage of share. Now they said these eight of them will work on it. They went to Tanzania, they did a lot of surveys, they met people, consumer survey, distribution survey, whatever. And then they prepared a report and they presented to the Coca-Cola team. And the Coca-Cola team was very impressed. They said, yes, this is very close to even what we used to think, but now we have got a scientific data to prove. And we now will be pushing because it requires budgetary allocation for the next steps to be done. And he said all six of these students were then hired when they passed on by Coca-Cola at very high salaries. Because they said the thing which you did in Tanzania can also be done in Indonesia. The methodology was right. This is academia industry partnership. Right? So in marketing field also it can be done by any college in India. I always tell whenever I go to any university, I tell the management and faculty that why don't you just pick up a 50 kilometer radius of your university and go and meet small medium enterprise and ask them pain points related to market, even if it is domestic market. What is the pain point? And see if you can develop a solution, you can charge a fees to them. A lot of universities told me, no, if we charge a fees, they don't agree to pay a small medium enterprise because the reputation in India for an academia to come out with a very practical business solutions is not very high. So I suggested to them, why don't you do one thing? You tell them that it will cost you 5 lakh rupees, for example, and you don't pay us right now. We will do the work. We'll go ahead. We will submit to you. If you are satisfied, you pay. And I'm telling you, I remember one university in Chennai who did it. And I told them, let me know what happens. And after 6 months, they came back saying, they not only gave us what we had asked, they gave us a bonus. Because they said it completely transformed their way of working. And they were so happy with it. They have in fact given us 2-3 more projects. So until and unless academia is solving the pain point of industry, till that time, this industry academia connect is not going to work. It has to be a win-win for both, right? So this is a very interesting thing. And then the industry part of it, so global market demand, industry part of it, of course, participate in all these initiatives which maybe government will launch. But my belief is very strong that everything which happens should happen between these three triangle. In India, I see government taking a lot of initiatives and interacting with industry, but not really interacting on business matters or industry matters with academia. This should increase. Government's interaction with academia should increase for industry aspects, right? That mindset change has to come. So first two, we have taken care now, efficiently create goods and services which meet global market demand. Now coming to the third part, leading to rising living standards for everybody in the society. Everybody in the society. That is the inclusivity, which should be. Then a nation is a nation. Only a certain percentage of people growing, which is always a very small percentage, is not a fair society, right? Because everyone is contributing. A construction company building a big mall, but that construction worker contributed to build that, right? But as he or she are they part of the, fruits. So like government, what is the role of government in this? So very interesting when this Jan Dhan account started, a lot of people were criticizing. I mean, see, whenever there used to be money transfer earlier, there would be so much of corruption. We know of a former Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi used to say out of 1 rupee, 15 paisa reaches. This is our Prime Minister. So it was known. So direct bank transfer kind of initiative is amazing. And Stand Up India. See, Stand Up India is for women entrepreneurs. So when I was doing this Mentor on Road tour in US, I had four agendas. That's why now I'm to relate it to Stand Up India. And so one in the morning, I used to go to universities and meet American startups. I used to explain them Startup India. And then in the afternoon, later part of morning, I would meet women-owned businesses through women associations, business associations. And I wanted to find out, you will be surprised that I was told that 35 years back, participation of women in American economy was 25%. And in 2017, when I did the tour, they were telling me participation of women in American economy is 65%. So I said, I want to know what happened in 35 years. What are the government initiatives or what are the private sector initiatives? And so I used to meet these women-owned business associations and the women entrepreneurs and try to understand best practices. And then I wanted, I recommended to the government of India. So Stand Up India, in India, I have been told, I don't know because I see very contradictory figures, but I am told that participation of women in Indian economy is 20%. You will be surprised. I don't know how much true that data is because everything about China is very difficult to confirm. But what I read was that in China, participation of women in Chinese economy is 76%. And if that is true, then that is one of the reasons of China's economic success. It is today a $14 trillion economy. We are a $2.9 trillion economy in India. America is $22 trillion economy. So Stand Up India, very interesting example. But is Stand Up India connected in any way to academia? Stand Up India is for industry, entrepreneurship, by way of women participation, by way of funding, by way of loan mechanism. But what is the connect with academia? Is it there or not? If it is not there, I don't see. Even money may be lent, even women may start some business, but will it succeed? Because see, the academia role in creating success in businesses is a very critical role. It is a part of competitiveness, triple LX model. So this perhaps has to be seen. Universities or colleges should try to see, can we develop a women, or a business oriented program? I mean, initiative, interact with them, have a cell, for example, or connect to Stand Up India and see how it can be. Again, 50 kilometer radius, 30 kilometer radius of the college or university. And then try to survey women-owned businesses and find out pain points and connect it to Stand Up India. Same way Startup India, our Prime Minister announced wonderful programs a few days back. And Shark Tank, in my opinion, Shark Tank kind of a program should have been started so long back. We all know we are never, ever, never, ever going to create jobs which are required. Never, ever. Doesn't matter how much percentage we grow. Even if we grow 20% GDP, 20%, we can't create jobs for all the people. Last year, 1.5 crore young Indians joined the job market. Every year it is going to increase. This year it will be 1.6 crores. There is no way we can create that many jobs. Forget it. Self-employment is the answer. So Startup India, very interesting initiative. So the startup champions, that is now, and I am glad I was looking at some of the aspects of startup champions, and the academia is involved. It will succeed. You know, until and unless government, academia, industry does something together, we cannot create a competitive economy. It is my very clear understanding. So these are some of the aspects of government. Now academia, what academia can do. Now on the rising living standard for everybody in the society. See, all said and done, even today, 65% of population of India lives in villages. We have 630,000 villages. Wherever a college or university is there, in the radius of 50 or 100 kilometers, there must be so many villages. I always, in Bangalore, I have motivated one university to adopt 4 villages to convert them into smart village. There is no better teaching than this. The college children are involved, faculty is involved, management is involved. Management is working as a CSR in that project. The faculty and students are going to the village, conducting interviews, finding out the pain point of the village and delivering solutions through industry, right? There is so much of CSR funding for any effective. So when these college students and faculty go to villages and identify pain points and deliver solutions, there is no better education than this. What is a better education than this in the practical sense? When they go out to the industry for jobs, they know the market, they know the problems of the society. Every problem of society, every pain point of society is a business opportunity. We know that. So this is how the integration of academia can and should be done in this triple LX model of competitiveness. And until and unless our villages become prosperous, what are we talking of India? Which India are we talking of? The 35% India, the urban India, or whatever percentage we have We can never ever become a prosperous nation unless villages become prosperous. What is the role of industry in leading to rising living standard for everybody in the society? I still recall Dhirubhai Ambani when he was in his last years. He used to say, we should come out with a 1 rupee product and we should see that 100 crore Indians buy it and you become a 100 crore turnover company. You know, that kind of a vision. So that is, you are actually serving so many, and in that process, so much of distribution network gets built. And your industry's role in rising living standard for everybody in the society is just to understand the pain point of the society and deliver a business solution. And this they can do more effectively in partnership with academia. Because see, one thing, I'm sure some of you will agree, or what is happening in Indian context is that the entrepreneurship, the business, small medium enterprise owners are entrepreneurial, very enterprising, amazing. I never find a more enterprising community anywhere in the world than Indians. But professionalism is lacking. Management skills are lacking. So if you marry the two, and the research skills are lacking. So if you marry industry with academia, you are creating a complete model of success, because academia doesn't have entrepreneurship in its, you know, fold in that way. But it certainly has the research skills. So what one is lacking, other has. What one is lacking, other has. Marry the two. It is the foundation of competitive economy. So together, and if industry doesn't take the lead, academia should take the lead. And again, as I said, 30 kilometer, 50 kilometer radius, go and meet and say, let us, you know, try to work on this. So this is rising. And then the last one, which is sustainable into the future. The fourth aspect of competitiveness. What is the role of government? See, programs like Clean India. I mean, I feel so ashamed sometimes that our Prime Minister has to climb on the Red Fort on 15th of August and appeal to the nation to keep India clean. I mean, is this something to be appealed, or is it a self-responsibility and an action orientation? So anyway, Clean India program, Swachh Bharat is something. Now, I do not know what is the role of academia in Swachh Bharat. I know the role of industry. I am working with them. Industry is working on Clean Ganga project with so much of business on so many, many other projects. But is academia involved? I am not aware. Maybe my research is not complete. But if it is involved, good. If not involved, there should be strong involvement in Clean India by the academia. On its own, initiative can be taken. And so at least whenever I go to any college, I always tell a university that at least your 10 kilometer radius you keep clean. That is your duty as a CSR. You are serving 20,000 youngsters as your students. This is your responsibility. Then eco-friendly policy. I don't think we have a national level eco-friendly policy. And zero effect is a very interesting government of India's approach. Zero effect. So zero effect on the environment. And that is something. Now, what is the role of academia in sustainability? So again, same model. I keep repeating everywhere same thing, because it is the same thing has to be done. To work with industry on eco-friendly products. On eco-friendly products. Now, because of the corona, in the initial days, April, everybody I used to see in the social media, Facebook and LinkedIn and Twitter, everybody posting pictures. Wow, what clear blue skies. I can see Himalayas from Jalandhar. And, you know, all those stories, and so peaceful and so green. And birds are flying freely. We all loved it. We all love, everybody, human loves nature. So we have, if we can sustain that as an eco-friendly way of living, then we are motivating that kind of a way. So academia can do a research paper on that. Eco-friendly products and solutions, showcasing them. See, this is also a challenge. I was interacting with some families. I said, you should buy eco. He said, where is it? Where do we find? Where do we get it? Is there a store? Is there? So something like that initiative. Can universities and colleges create a small space? See, all universities and colleges have canteen. Why they have canteen? So that students and faculty can go and eat. Can we have one eco-friendly shop in the college? What does it take as a resource? Nothing, one room, maybe one person who can also be a volunteer student, which keeps rotating. Identify eco-friendly products around your surroundings or across the country. Put it up. That will motivate the students and even industry visitors coming to do something out of it. You know, so ultimately it is the showcase of everything which will lead to something. Just thinking about it or talking about it is not going to lead to that. And innovation, see, innovation, sustainability into the future. I was very surprised, and I really impressed also that in China, innovation is a subject being taught from class 5. There's a chapter on innovation in class 5, in class 6, in class 7, in class 8. There are chapters on innovation. I don't know whether it is part of our curriculum in India or not yet, in the new education policy maybe. As part of curriculum in school, we talk in college about incubation center. Why can there not be an incubation center in school? I still can't understand. It has to start from there. That is the stage where children have the most open mind to adopt ideas. Later on, it becomes rigid. So then what is the role of industry? I'll give you a very interesting example, and I'll encourage all of you to check that. Let me see if the name I'm saying is correct or not. I would like to give you a very interesting example. So you can go to one website which is called eco-friendly biz, eco-friendly products.biz. Let me write here. This is interesting because, you know, this is the way to go about. So where is the chat here? Yeah, okay, I got Tripti, you are there?
Yes, sir, on the right hand side, sir, you'll see the chat.
Okay, I got it. So I posted in the chat. You can check this. So this company is in Surat, and when pandemic started, he was saying my textile plant is closed and you know, workers are not there and I'm not able to do anything. After 2 months, he told me, and I said, you do one thing, you start sourcing eco-friendly products from across the country and develop a business line on this. This is the future. And in any case, you are sitting at home, your factory is closed, you're free all day, you do that, hire some youngsters from the university. Youngsters are also at home, studying online, they have time. Very good opportunity, you hire them, find out all eco-friendly products across the country, talk to them, get a supply base developed and build a portal. This portal has been built. Now 105 products are there. And they are targeting to reach 1,001 products by December end this year. Now already 105 products, and they have now started giving franchise. They have developed a Buy Eco, BY-Eco brand and trademarked it. Now they have started giving the franchise of Buy Eco, that all these products are organic and certified and recyclable and biodegradable and compostable. Different products have different qualities. And they have started giving franchise in US, Canada, Australia, Japan, Europe, all developed countries. And people are lapping it up. And he is in fact not able to supply now because there is so much of demand. See, a lockdown guy, textile factory closed, went into the business. He's saying, I may not even revive my textile business. Maybe he told me, can you get it sold? Because he sees such a big opportunity here. And he involved South Gujarat University in this. See, this is the beauty why I gave this example. He involved the university to get interns for this business, and the interns have done that work. If you go to the website, you will find the interns also pictures there. See, this is a very interesting example of academia industry partnership. So friends, this is what primarily, okay. I wanted to share. And one more.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. We couldn't see any link posted on the chat, sir. Can you please post it again?
No, I posted it. It is seen me. Your. It is just below you, Tripti, Dikshit. Sir, kindly share audio video blue button. Then after that, I have posted.
Okay, sir. Let me check where have you.
It is there on the. But otherwise, it is eco-friendly products.biz, B-I-Z, eco, E-C-O, friendly, F-R-I-N-D-L-Y, products.biz, .biz. I just posted it. I can see it being, in the posting. I again posted second time.
Okay, so you posted it in backstage? Fair enough, sir. Okay.
So let me, okay. Posted it on stage. Okay, I got it.
I'll just put it
on. Okay, I posted on stage now.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, you got it, no?
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Very good. So the point, friends, so now I want to throw one challenge to ITTO and all participants. Can we do some kind of an example of global competitiveness? We are talking of competitiveness so far of a nation. Can we do some program on global competitiveness? For example, transnational triple helix, government, academia, industry. Can we have one academia from US? Can we have one industry from India? And can we work with government of Rwanda? Why Rwanda in Africa? Because that's a very progressive government. The president is a Harvard graduate and very progressive minded. Can a global competitiveness approach be taken? Can these three nations work on so many aspects of this triple helix, government, academia, industry, connect, and see that how, so the industry in India will benefit out of it, the academia will get a global experience, and the Rwanda will benefit by way of, you know, whatever outcome comes of it. So we need to move to those models. Then there will be so much of learnings which can then be translated to each of the country and even can be shared globally. So many case studies can be developed on this. And lastly, I want to leave this thought to all of you, then we can have Q&A. And is that, see, what has happened for many, many years, but suddenly now, last 2-3 years, is that the change is the permanent constant. Change is the permanent constant now. So I always tell industry people, the way you have been doing business last 2 years, if nothing in that has changed in aspects of production, finance, HR, marketing, whatever functions of business, if nothing much has changed, you are not going to survive. So either you can be a victim of change or you can be an agent of change. Very simple. 1 year from now, whenever any company is going to come to me and say that I am in trouble, I'll simply do a change audit of theirs. And I'll try to see, did they change or not at the right time? And mostly they would not have changed. That is why they are in trouble. So this change audit can become part of academia work. I don't know any academia doing change audit work. It is amazing. It can be done in area of technology. It can be done in area of marketing, in area of all four aspects of competitiveness. Change audit can be developed. And that itself will be a huge learning for the faculty and the students. And maybe government will get so much of information out of it, because change, nobody wants to change, right? So if reasons are identified and if it is related to non-growth or problem of survival for industry, then it gets proven scientifically that how change is important, you know. So this is it from my side. This is what some of the thoughts I thought I must share, and based on my experiences. So is there any, are there any questions, Trupti, how you want to go now?
So let me just check in the chat. Okay. Do we have any questions?
Okay.
So thank you so much. I you know what, I feel that the time given to you was way too less than what you could have shared with all of us.
We
could actually hear from you, but wonderful, sir. Thank you so much for sharing such encouraging real life success stories with our participants. Meanwhile, I would request all the participants to please write down your questions, and you are free to chat with sir. You can just turn on your mic and have discussion with sir. Sir is here with us. Sir, thank you so much for giving us key points to establish a more directional approach towards collaboration, such as developing technology-based solutions, creating goods and services with valuable proposition, contributing on priority setting, identification of relevant technologies for medium enterprises, and giving solution to industry pain points. And very rightly said, sir, the how the academia may contribute, that is by adopting these virtual surveys and expos and being very active about it. Also, the industry and MSME, they should target more of global market demand and look out for in-licensing and validated technologies from academia to enter into global markets. And it is great to understand government's role in facilitating academia-industry collaboration. And of course, now the new concept has emerged, which is vice versa. How industry and academia together, they can seek government support. So looking for those possible solutions. And lastly, sir, the regional development and triple helix model, which you have given us a new perspective about, that how we can integrate these two to have three A's in place: accessibility, affordability, and availability of basic and advanced solutions, so that the quality of life for all improves and we move towards sustainable growth. So wonderful, sir. I think there were a lot of more points which I have missed on even jotting down, but then I would really request all our participants, in case you have any question or you would like to have any discussion with sir, sir is here with us. Please feel free to switch on your mic and speak with us. Or you can just write here in the chat box and we'll be connecting you.
Thank you.
Or else even after the session, please feel free to reach out to sir. He is actually known as Mentor on Road, and I'm sure he'll be there to help you as well in case you have any query.
Yes, absolutely. I have 6 businesses. I do not put any of time on my business. My people manage it. I'm always free.
Wonderful, sir.
So I should go to somewhere else, or what should I do?
Yes, sir. I don't see any questions coming up from a participant, sir. So, sir, you may please feel free to visit our booths.